Welcome to the colorful world of conceptualism or conceptual music from around the last decade. My lecture has a formal concept itself. It consists of examples and of theory about it, and the one is decreasing and the other one is increasing, but it's not completely symmetrical. And here we go. A couple of years ago in Ireland, there was a piano competition, and the organizers also wanted an Irish composer to write a new piece that is played by the pianist. And of course, you can imagine that most composers would contribute a virtuoso piece. But Jennifer Walsh was asked, and she has a different idea. She simply said, okay, the pianist should take any piece of the virtuoso literature and play it one semitone higher. In Weiß Weißlich by Peter Ablinger. Peter Ablinger describes different kinds of noise, Rauschen, to be heard as musical pieces. For example, he says a waterfall, a fountain, rain, wind, the sea. Or he describes certain places, like the cloister with the fountain house in Lilienfeld, Austria, or the Whitethorn Wood in Hiddensee, Germany. Or he simply puts a set of chairs on certain places where people are then invited to sit down and listen to the concert that is played there. So that's the piece I composed for the Arditti String Quartet. I'm talking now about technical setups that are re-rendering or re-enacting the historical avant-garde, I would say. There are quite a lot of examples for that. For example, Matthew Wright made a new version of John Cage's famous 4 minutes, 33 seconds, the autotune version. You maybe know autotune is a software that automatically brings every input into the chromatic scale. And Matthew Wright took a recording of silence and fed it into autotune. And for the first movement, he adjusted C minor, and for the second movement, C major, and for the third, E flat major. And that's how silence sounds like when it is put into autotune. It's very soft. Or Patrick Little made a new version of the famous piece "I Am Sitting in a Room" of Evan Lucier, but Patrick Little realized it in the virtual room of the internet. So he recorded himself as audio and video and speaks the text of Lucier, but a bit changed in his way. He's realizing the project. That's the video.
I'm sitting in a room different from the one you are in now. I'm recording the sound of my speaking voice as well as the image of myself, and I'm going to upload it to YouTube, rip it from YouTube, and upload it again and again until the original characteristics of both my voice and my image are destroyed. What you will see and hear then are the artifacts inherent in the video codec of both YouTube and the MP4 format I convert it to on my computer.
So this is the video he's uploading to YouTube and then downloading again and uploading and downloading and uploading and downloading. And each time he's doing it, again, these compression algorithms compress the file. And he did it 1,000 times. And that's how it looks like after 1,000 times. Or in my music theater piece Fietz Hören TV, I made a new version of Der kranke Mond out of Piero Lunaire, the famous expressionist piece with his female voice. But in my case, this voice was spoken by a car navigation device.
Du nicht dich totes kranker Mond dort auf des Himmels schwarzem Pfühl, dein Blick so fiebernd übergroß, band mich wie fremde Melodie. An unstillbarem Liebesleid stirbst du, an Sehnsucht tief erstickt. Du nicht dich totes kranker Mond dort auf des Himmels schwarzem Pfühl, den Liebsten, der im Sinnenrausch gedankenlos zur Liebsten geht, belustigt.
Or another Schönberg, new version of a Schönberg piece was made by Cory Archangel, the three piano pieces Opus 11. He arranged them with samples of videos of cats walking on keyboards from YouTube. Thank you. Kind of new version of the Bolero by Maurice Ravel was realized by Alexander Kravchenko. His piece is simply called Crescendo. The idea was to have several small loudspeakers and give any inputs into them. He does it with rock music, and then he increases the volume more and more and more and more and more until the loudspeakers get damaged and stop to play. Unfortunately, I don't have more video footage of this really funny and unexpected things happen then. The loudspeakers start to jump and crash in different ways. Now something different. Giuliano Obici, in his piece By Auri, he has the following concept. A sum of $1 is paid to people in exchange for them listening to 3 minutes of sound on a pair of headphones. This value relates to the amount of time and the average cost of commercialized music on the web. So that is was a performance on the streets of Sao Paulo, where he realized it. In a similar way goes my piece Fremdarbeit, outsourcing, where I received a commission from the Festival Klangwerkstatt Berlin for a new piece for a given instrumentation. But then I didn't compose the piece. Instead, I looked for composers who offer their skills to write music for you, and especially in China there are lots of them, and so I found on the web this one, Qianlong Chang, and I gave him several pieces of mine with the task, please write now a new piece for the new instrumentation which has to sound like my other pieces. And I also found an Indian programmer whom I gave the same pieces with the task to write a software which algorithmically is imitating my music. And so there's a question of authorship, but also, again, of the costs of music. Since these both guys are living or were living in China and India, they were quite cheap. That cost me $150, whereas I received €1,500 for this commission. So I switched the production into countries with cheap wages, like industry does as well.
Okay, this is a nice concept, but do I have to listen to this?
Yeah, that's the question that often arises. Do I have to listen to this, actually? In the case of Piece Fremdarbeit, I would say, of course, that's the interesting thing. How does this music sound like, which is has a completely different way of how it is, how it was written. So this has two aspects, but of course in other concerts it's, as I admit, it's not so important to listen to it, or not primarily, or it is not, at least not a concert hall piece, but an installation or a YouTube video. For example, this Cory Archangel piece, Schönberg, Opus 11, Cute Kittens. I like the idea very much, but I never watched the whole three piano pieces on YouTube. So the one aspect is that music is a time-based media. That's the big difference, of course, to visual arts. In visual arts, you can create these big symbols. One example, Marina Abramovic, a big symbol with these bones and flesh for the war on the Balkan. Yeah, but a big symbol in music would be have a big duration, and long durations are problematic in time simply, and in music it becomes boring, and so that's in this way not possible in music, at least not in concert hall. An interesting piece which is thinking about this is Quadrat, Square by Peter Ablinger. Again, a kind of reenactment of a historical avant-garde piece, in this case the Black Square by Kazimir Malevich, a painting which is simply a black square. And Ablinger said, asked himself, okay, what could a black square be in music? So he thought, okay, that would be white noise. He says white noise is even softer than silence because it swallows everything. Yeah, but then he posed the question, what do you think, how long would this white noise be that you have the impression, now, okay, this is now like a square? Last year in Jennifer Wall's class, I asked this, we played it, and people raised their hands when they thought, okay, now that this duration would be kind of square for me. It was, of course, very different from a few seconds until a few minutes. Peter Ablinger said for him it would be 4 minutes. For me it would be 8 seconds. And the second aspect is what I call prepared listening. In conceptual music, often it's the case that you have to know the concept. The music is not self-explaining. In a way, you have to already be prepared when listening to the sound. And that's a bit of taboo, because a lot of people, they don't want to be prepared. They just want to listen to the music, without prejudices, and without any preparation in advance. That's of course legitimate and okay, but for some pieces, for some conceptual pieces, it is necessary, and then you have to accept this thing. I compare it with prepared piano. So, often conceptual music pieces are small, are short, the normal thing is it's one idea, not more and not less. But that's not necessarily the case that it's always small. On the opposite, one concept can give rise to quite a big diversity. For example, in my piece Product Placements, the idea was I composed a 33-second long tape piece which was containing 70,200 quotes, and then I registered this piece correctly at the GEMA. I showed this 2 years ago in this in my lecture in Darmstadt, the German Association for Performance Rights and Copyright Law. And so necessarily, that was a truck full of 70,200 registration forms. So first of all, there was the piece, the 33-second long piece that I composed. That's how it sounds. That was not so difficult to compose with algorithms. It was possible to do in 2 days. Much more time was spent for printing out the registration forms. That was 6 or 7 weeks. Yeah, but that also belongs to the concept, of course. And then I wrote and published an essay about the problems of music and copyright law in the digital age. And I made a YouTube video with an interview of a lawyer explaining this whole situation and the problems around. And yeah, then this was published on YouTube and it went viral worldwide. This in August 2008, it was really seen all over the world 100,000 times. And then I made this performance in September 2008, came with a truck to the GEMA Generaldirektion in Berlin. And so that then a 2-hour discussion was held inside the GEMA. And until now, I'm asked for giving an interview or a statement about the problems of music in the digital age and all this with copyright law. So to say, this piece, this performance is still going on. Or another example is Swiss composer Patrick Frank, The Law of Quality, where he wrote as a commission a song for voice and piano, which is called The Law of Quality. And now this score he put into a frame and offered it to be that it can be bought. He made a website, lawofquality.com, where he showed the concept. The concept was that the first buyer, for him it's very cheap, I don't know, $500. When he then sells the piece again, it will be $1,000. And when he sells it again, it will be, I don't know, 2,000 and so on and so forth. Each time when it's sold, the price has to be higher. And Frank says, according to a text of the art historian Wolfgang Ulrich, that the higher the price is, the better the piece, in fact, is, which is really a common thing at the arts market. And so Patrick Frank wanted to focus at this point, especially on the website. It is well documented. The piece was already sold several times. And he also made advertisement in new music magazines, and he also made videos.
Quality.
And in the song, the voice is again describing the whole concept.
But that's not music. I'm not sure if this is art at all, or if you're trying to make a joke.
Yeah, don't compare it with Lachenmann, and don't compare it with Fernihau, don't compare it with written music for written scores for being played at the concert. Of course, this kind of conceptual music is not so much about expressiveness, not so about doesn't have formal qualities, doesn't have the power of performance, and but there are other qualities instead. It's widening your perception. It's maybe it's a matter of taste. What you like more, and it can be funny. Yes, why not? But I think there can be a peaceful coexistence, or I at least have a bit the idea to do both. Gerhard Richter is painting these abstract paintings, and on the other hand, his conceptual photorealistic paintings. A new set of examples. Peter Aplinger in his famous cycle Voices and Piano, there you can take any recording of a spoken text, and with the help of a software, Aplinger is translating this speaking melody into a piano piece, and then both the piano piece and the original recording is played together. It's a kind of pitch digitalization of the spoken text.
Also mir hat mein Name immer sehr gut gefallen, Hannah. Das war für mich immer dieses Hannah. Und irgendwie wollte ich schon, dass in meinem Leben mit uns, dass das eine Aufgabe in meinem Leben war, dass ich so richtig zum Ausatmen komme. Weil angefangen habe ich eigentlich anderswo, weil ich mehr eingearbeitet bin als Ausgabe.
Or another version of it is where only the piano is speaking, which is possible with a player piano. But it's interesting, it only works when the text is additionally written down. So again, with a bit of prepared listening, then you get it. So what I'm talking now about is technical setups as a concept. I think that's a point which is nowadays, you find it more and more, also in concert music. I would say Simon Steen Andersen's piece, Black Box Music, is also, first of all, it is the concept of his new built instrument, or Stefan Prinz, Piano Hero, is also, first of all, the idea is a technical setup, a kind of concept, which then opens a space for music. In my piece, Universität der Toten Philosophen, University of Dead Philosophers, I'm playing on a MIDI keyboard, but the keyboard is programmed in a way that the tone does not come when you press the key, but when you release the key, which goes completely against your feeling of playing the piano, which you learned in your whole life. And so please believe me now, and now I'm playing a fugue by Bach on it, out of the Art of Fugue, and please believe me, I'm playing it rhythmically correct. I've practiced it very hard, but the result is a very deconstructed fugue. Peter Aplinger is working a lot with new technical setups as a concept for music. In his cycle Instrumente und Rauschen, for example, for orchestra, the idea was that an orchestra is playing well-known music, in this case pieces by Stravinsky, Schönberg, Boulez, Stockhausen, Ligeti, Nono, but additionally out of speakers noise is played, and with exactly these frequencies that occur in these musical pieces, so that ideally it completely fits. But of course, in reality, it never fits completely. Or in my piece, or in my concept Pixeled, the idea was that you can take any MIDI file of music, and then each bar is put together into one chord. So, for example, I've done it with a piece by Beethoven. Now, please try to find out which piece is it. It's easy. Okay, now another kind of concepts, no more technical setups. Californian composer Mark Sow, since a couple of years, since 2005, I think, he is writing concepts. And this is his work list from his website. It's an incredible amount of concepts he has already written in the last 7 years. It's over 1,000. But each of them is, in my opinion, at least it reads beautifully. For example, it looks like this. He takes an object from daily life and writes a concept on it. Or this one. Or this one. But most of his pieces are verbal notations. For example, this, A Kind of Sleep, often with the motto of John Asbury. And this piece is for one sustaining white noise, one sustaining high bowed string instrument, and one field recording, generally featureless, very long. And there's, as far as I heard, there's a whole scene in California, but also connected to Berlin, of composers who write these kind of verbal pieces. Well, there's also this Wandelweiser group dealing with such kind of concepts, and Michael Winter, who is also one composer, could be mentioned. And recently, John Lilly and James Saunders published this book, World Events, Perspectives on Verbal Notation, with pieces from Cage to Walsh.
But that's not new.
Okay, let's... What about the history of musical conceptualism, or conceptualism at all? Of course, there's not the grandfather, but the pater, the godfather. Yeah. There's the godfather, Marcel Duchamp, and in music you could mention Eric Satie. I would also mention Maurice Ravel's Bolero is a kind of conceptual piece, avant la lettre. And then, of course, there is Saint John Cage. And this generation that came up in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, that's John Cage, Lamont Young, The Fluxus, people, of course, Yoko Ono, Nam June Paik, or Dick Higgins. So these, I would say, are the grandfathers of conceptual music. But also the composers that are well known for writing concert music wrote some concepts like Giorgi Ligeti, the piece for 100 metronomes, the Middle Stockhausen, Aus den Sieben Tagen, are conceptual pieces. Matthias Spalinger wrote his book Konzepte. And then the next generation, or the same generation, more or less the father generation, I would call this, would be then Evel Lucie, of course, Dieter Schnebel, and then Christian Marclay, Tom Johnson, and Peter Ablinger, and of course much, much more. I haven't chosen for this lecture. I can, if you go to this exhibition at the Mathildenhöhe here, A House Full of Music, it's a very a great exhibition where you can see the history of a lot of examples of the history of conceptual music. But I have the opinion that in the 70s and especially in the 80s and also beginning of 90s, there was not so much conceptual music. There was this first generation around John Cage and Fluxus, but then especially in the 80s, it's also in the visual arts, there was a strong movement against conceptualism. At least in Germany, there was, for example, the neo-expressionistic movement, the Neuen Wilden. And I think in the music, it's a bit the same. Of course, there were some composers like Alvin Lucier who worked continuously. But I think only in beginning of or mid of 90s, a new wave of musical conceptualism came up until now, especially with Peter Ablinger. And now with, is it new or not? Difficult question. But we are dealing all with this problem everywhere. The string quartet is also not new, but still composers are writing a lot for it. So we have to listen to it looking for the new aspects in a different way. And the same is it with musical conceptualism. But for example, I would say a new thing is the big amounts. I showed you Mark Sow. In only 7 years, he wrote over 1,000 concepts. Itself, that's a concept of creating concepts. Or another nice example, okay, by the way, there is a book you can read about the history of conceptual music, conceptualisms. But for example, the Krupert project by Jennifer Walsh is a virtual group of artists, which are in fact all alter egos of Jennifer Walsh herself. But with this setting, with this approach to publish under different names and under different biographies, it is possible then to create a big amount of pieces, of performances, of objects, of paintings, of photographs, of clothes, whatever. So this is almost without any border under this whole overall concept of having this virtual artist group. So again, the big amount that comes up. Now, but still a problem is the time-based media, that's not so many composers are writing conceptual music compared to visual arts, where conceptualism now is much, much more widespread. But with new technology, especially new possibilities are there, new ways of presenting it. As I said, prepared listening, people have to know the concept, so that's a bit difficult in the concert. For example, with my piece Fremdarbeit, where the Asian composers composed for me, a program note just wouldn't be enough, because it's not sure if people read it, but it is necessary that people know the concept, so then I moderated the piece, for example. But you can also use, for example, video now to do that. And I'm asked myself, how did the first generation of conceptualists, how did they solve this problem to tell people the concept? Of course, John Cage was a performer himself, and he was a great lecturer. But I researched also how did he do it, and then I read that he hang his course on the wall in the concert hall so that people know, aha, this is variations too, comes up from these different layers put on top of each other, for example. Another solution for the problem of that concepts are small is what I would compare with the Petersburg hanging. The Petersburg hanging means that a lot of images are hanging together, very near to each other. And I would say this could also be a strategy in music. Only one single concept is maybe not really a work. Yeah? But then collect a bunch of concepts and hang them together. And as you maybe noticed already, my lecture is following exactly this strategy. Okay, another set of examples. In his Applaus-Dusche, the Applaus-Shower, Manos Tsongaris made an installation where there is a loudspeaker on top of you and you have a button that you press and then applause comes out of, so to say, the shower. Or now it becomes a bit political. In my piece Charts Music, I derived melodies from stock exchange values at the climax of the financial crisis 2009, and then I arranged it with the composition software SongSmith by Microsoft, which then sounds like this. I've showed it already 2 years ago, so I only show a small... can watch it on the web. So what I'm now talking about is the shift to content orientation, die gehaltsästhetische Wende, the German philosopher Harry Lehmann is describing. That the progress of material in music has maybe come to an end point, almost, not completely, but to a certain degree it has come to an end. And then there comes a shift to content orientation, that the material is then applied to somehow data from reality. For example, Christian Marclay's guitar track looks like this.
I've always been interested in how sound is visualized.
Video. Now you can say, hey, that's not a new idea. Nam June Paik already tracked a violin in public space in the 60s. But Christian Marclay, he referred to a case that happened in the USA where some white guys captured a black guy and they tortured him to death with dragging him behind a jeep, like Marclay then did with the guitar. So that's a shift to content orientation, I would say. Or at the moment I'm working on a piece called Enigma Variations. Algorithmic composition is a well-known thing now, but I thought about, what about algorithms in real life? Or are there political algorithms also? And there is one famous or infamous, this one. That's the Enigma decoding and encoding and decoding machine of the Deutsche Wehrmacht used in the Second World War to encode important front information so that it is only, so to say, noise. And then, of course, it can be decoded again. But the enemy shouldn't be able to read it, but due to Alan Turing, then the Britons were fortunately able to read this German information. Yeah, but so there is this Enigma algorithm of the Deutsche Wehrmacht, and I'm thinking about a piece where I take music and I'm encoding it with the Enigma machine into kind of noise, and then of course again noise can be decoded again into ordinary music. So, why is there a new conceptualism? I would say there is a state of a ripe postmodernism where a view on music is quite in an objective way. It is objects. There are objects in music that can be used with a certain function. There is new technology which gives a lot of possibilities now to create pieces beyond the concert hall, and maybe on the internet is also necessary to think more conceptual. At least I know that it's hard to listen to a one-hour symphony on the internet. Of course, there's thousands of links to click on, so therefore concert hall is still the best place acoustically, of course, also. And whereas when you make art for the internet, maybe you should it should be more in a short, small, conceptual way. Then, what I call the shift to content orientation, die als ästhetische Wende. So, and there occur themes or specific approaches that I showed here. For example, reenactments of the avant-garde. I'm seeing more and more of these pieces where people are, with new technology, are reenacting well-known pieces of the avant-garde. Or there are special technical setups that form a kind of concept, like Peter Ablinger does very often. Or data from real life, example from politics and economy, are applied on musical parameters with the help, for example, of video. And I come to my last examples. Richard Clover, in his piece Logical Harmonies, the score looks like this. The pianist is playing a complete cycle of fifths. And when it's done, then next time the left hand is starting from F major. The right hand always starts from C major, but then the left hand from F major, and then playing this cycle of fifths. And then the next time the left hand starts from B flat major, and so on, until the left hand has also gone through the whole cycle of fifths, and then the piece is over. So that's completely, yeah, I could say, a logical progress. Takes about 4 minutes, but in the end they are again at C major. Coming to the end, I want to try to give definitions or describe characteristics of musical conceptualism nowadays. Certainly, I want to go away from the classical definition of conceptual art from the 60s, where it was radical to say the concept is more important than the realization. But nowadays, in the visual arts, for example, when you go to the Documenta or to the Venice Biennale, you see lots of conceptual art, but it's not only the concept. It is realized. It is visible or somehow perceptible. And the same, I would say, is with music. Away from a classical concept definition, Matthias Sparlinger is saying that every piece since atonality has a conceptual aspect, since before there was a concept of tonality. So you can also view it from this perspective. Okay, definitions or characteristics. Conceptual music could consist of a single idea which produces a whole piece. Good example is the piece Poème Symphonique by Giorgi Ligeti with the 100 metronomes. Simply these 100 metronomes started together, but creating a big and very complex piece. Or a principle which can be realized in different ways with various inputs. For example, these technical setups, Voices and Piano by Peter Aplinger, which can fit with theoretically with every spoken text, or my keyboards with the inversion of the keys. You can try to play every piece of piano music there. Or an idea that has to do with music but isn't necessarily sound. For example, this noise pieces of Peter Aplinger, where he's describing certain places. You can go there, but maybe you only read the concept and imagine it. Or I would say a lot of pieces by Marc Sow, for example. Or also Trond Reinholzen trying to use these music theory books as wind instruments is not really sound. Yeah. Or, and that might be the newest definition, that there is a piece of music where an additional verbal or visual information is crucial, like my piece Fremdarbeit, for example, or Compression Sound Art, where you then need a different way of presenting it. So, if you're interested furthermore, the November issue of the Positionen magazine is about Neue Konzeptualisten. There will be also an essay by me in it. Thank you very much for your attention.